Are you a fan of Home and Family? If you're in the Los Angeles area and would like to be a part of our audience, send us an email at hnfaudience@gmail.com. Audience members must be 12 years of age and older, and groups of up to 4 people are welcome. We'd love to see you here in our home.
Hey. We're back. I'm so excited to share the story of this young man with you. You know him from so many wonderful shows like Nurse Jackie and The Good Wife and The Wire. Please welcome.
24.
And 24. Venga Akiname
so good.
Is here.
Thank
so,
you.
Thank you. You know, like you said, you sort of came out of, you have all these wonderful shows to your name, and playing some of these tough characters, but it started off at a point where you were actually born homeless.
Yes, yes.
Explain that. Share that with our audience.
Well, my mother had just come from Nigeria with my father. Well, they actually came to Canada first, and they came down to D.C., and she was pregnant with me. And that's where I was Aww. Born.
There's a picture mom. Of there.
Oh, that's so sweet. So you're yes. born there, and it was very difficult because you were homeless. But how did those circumstances affect your growing up and especially your schooling?
Well, you know, kids need stability, whether it's stability at home or with school, and I didn't really have either. Initially, when my mother left the hospital, she stayed on different people's couches. From what she tells me, 13 people, she'd go to their homes and just kind of rotate. And eventually, she got a place and started to work as a cleaner, which you clean people's homes. And she did that for a couple of years, and then my sister came over from Nigeria when she was 8. And I had another brother born here, and then we were homeless again. So we lived in a shelter in Maryland, in Bethesda.
What was life like in a shelter as a young child? Did you know, like, were you aware of the surroundings? And
yeah, you're kind of somewhat aware, but they also, it was a shelter for families and with children, so they have activities to kind of keep the children occupied and distracted.
Yeah. Sure.
So I remember those. I remember, you know, sometimes going on, like, little trips, and I remember the green walls and other kids and so on.
Green.
But I also remember it's weird because sometimes you have these regulations and these rules, and so parents are not allowed to work, they have to be with their kids, and so, but my, you know, how do you get out the shelter if you can't?
Yeah.
So
yeah.
My mother ended up basically sneaking out to look for work and then finding work, and then eventually we moved into project housing.
Were you a troubled child?
Ah!
Okay.
No, I was just misunderstood. I got a little bit of trouble, a lot of trouble.
You weren't arrested or anything like that, were you?
Define arrested.
Yeah, right.
Okay, so you got in trouble.
Because if you run fast enough, you know.
But, you know, as you look back at that child, though, and I mean, it was a path of certainty going down that road.
Absolutely.
And not having that structure.
Absolutely.
At what point, because obviously we're talking about the accolades, things shifted for you. Was there an epiphany? Was there a moment? Was there an event that happened that moved you from the dark to the light, if you will?
I would say that it was my junior year. Like my whole adolescence, I was in and out of institutions and schools for troubled youth, special ed. But it was my junior year when I was allowed to mainstream into my home school for at least 2 periods. And I was still in the other school for 2 periods and allowed to work for the rest of the day. But when I was in the home school now, I was allowed to do an after-school activity. And I went out for the wrestling team. And that just changed the whole vector of my life. I was good at it. I started to become empowered and self-possessed. And I saw that I could affect change in my own life.
Mm-hmm.
And I got recruited Division I the next year. It was a very interesting road.
Well, I know that you had a twist of fate in 2001, and it really kick-started your acting career. What was that?
Well, I'd graduated from Bucknell, and then I worked for the federal government for about a year at the Corporation for National Service, like the headquarters of AmeriCorps and VISTA. And I kind of got curious about acting, not so much so like that I wanted to pursue it, but just I like learning. So I bought some books and started researching online and started going on auditions near where I was working, still not really trying to pursue it, but just fascinated about this whole world. And then I got a call offering me a role at the Shakespeare Theater in D.C., and I kind of freaked out because, I wasn't seriously trying to pursue it, and I kind of just hung up real quick. I'll call you back, and just hung up. And then, like, 5 seconds later, my uncle called me and told me my father died, and that was just like...
After you...
Yeah, I didn't even think. I just got up and went into my supervisor's office and resigned. And it was just, I had to go. It was time to go.
That was it.
Yeah. Yeah. That whole week was really wild because I went from picking out funeral arrangements for somebody I had a very complicated relationship with during the day, and then at night rehearsing a theater play. It's something I'd never done before with people I'd grown up watching on television. So it was just like a fog of like.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
So yeah, you've been so successful at it too.
I've been very fortunate.
Wonderful people you've met, and you've gotten to star in these huge television series. And.
But there's a part too where there's the work ethic that's involved, and I want to talk to you about Knucklehead, which is something
you
produced,
love that title.
You directed. Did you write?
Well, I didn't direct it. I produced it, and I'm the lead.
It's an independent film,
yes,
right?
Yes,
yeah,
it
that's
is.
Great. And it was just, where did it play just recently?
We sold out at the new Black Voices of Cinema at the BAM in Brooklyn. It's the Brooklyn Academy of Music, and we're about to. What day is this airing?
Monday.
Okay, well, we would have just had our West Coast premiere at the Dances with Films Festival at Mann's Chinese Grumman's Theater, which I'm very excited about. Yeah.
But you connect with this character.
I do.
Tell us a little. This character is what? He's sort of feeling trapped, in much the way you did.
Yes. Yes. He's Langston. He is. We don't really pinpoint exactly what his limitations are, mm-hmm. but let's say he's got some developmental delays. I think of him as kind of high functioning and autistic, and he's kind of with it enough to know that he's different from everyone else, but he still thinks that he can fix that with the right combination of medication.
Right.
So he's constantly trying to pursue the right combination of drugs, pharmaceutical drugs, to fix his developmental delays.
Sure.
And there are no drugs that can fix that.
Well, we have a scene of you trying to get a doctor to prescribe you those pills. Well,
yes,
let's take a look.
So all you got to do is write the prescription for the emetride and the epinephrine and dominoes. We got us a jump ball.
Sorry, just can't do that.
I see you won some awards.
What?
On your wall.
Oh, you mean my diplomas? Yes, well, they do have special meaning. That one there, my baccalaureate, had to be replaced owing to some smoke. Hey, where are you going?
Aww, hard.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You connect with him.
Yeah. I do. I do. He's on a journey. I mean, I empathize with people, with characters that are trying to do the best they can with the limitations they have. So these characters speak to me. I guess it reflects elements of my own life, obviously.
Right.
But and he's trying to get a home for himself and leave the circumstances where he lives, where the relationship isn't so good with his mother, and he keeps talking about this girlfriend that no one's ever seen, that she's trying to get a place for him and this girlfriend.
You end up rooting for him, right?
I hope so.
Yeah.
Yeah. He's on his odyssey. To me, this is his odyssey.
Well, good luck with your career and
Knucklehead
and all the other things.
Thank you very much.
And I
come back and play another game with us.
Yeah, we will win.
Next time we win.
Information on New York and San Francisco screenings this weekend. You can go to knuckleheadfilm.com. All right, we are coming back. Debbie's here. She's going to show us how to be fashionable at any age.
Thank you.
Thank you.